America's manned space program began with the Redstone. Atlas followed, pushing the first American into orbit. Titan powered the Gemini program. And the mighty Saturn put man on the moon. Each of these relied on ocean landings and recovery, making the role of the pararescue men vital. With the introduction of the space shuttle, the PJ's role has changed into an elite contingency force.
Gentlemen, all of you are accomplished pararescue men or you wouldn't be here. We have just 5 short days to teach you the most specialized area of your field. Rescue support for the space transportation system.
First thing we'll talk about is the launch entry helmet. This is the helmet that the astronauts will be wearing on launch and entry.
As a service to NASA, the DoD provides an astronaut rescue and recovery capability. A part of that capability is provided by 23rd Air Force pararescuemen.
The first phase of training deals primarily with survivor extraction. The PJs then learn to use their highly specialized personal equipment. Staff Sergeant Mark Judy, Chief of Pararescue Training.
Okay, this morning we're training in wetsuits and familiarizing the guys with the rafts and the procedures here in the water. The water is definitely the hardest thing to do here, so what we do is train the guys in the wetsuits initially, let them get used to the procedures.
We offer a fully equipped, technically trained, and precise rescue operation.
Master Sergeant Tony McFarr, Superintendent, Shuttle Pararescue Training.
All PJs come to us with basic pararescue skills, but this mission is different. Because of the hazardous and toxic environment associated with the shuttle, we've developed specialized equipment and procedures for the successful extraction of astronauts.
Okay, go!
Team 2 will be coming in as Team 3, and 3 will be alternating as 2. Yeah, come on through. Okay, Team 1 will be over on this side. Team 3 will come in this side. Team 2 will be behind them. And when I give you guys the high sign out there...
Captain Stack Stahelski, Kennedy Space Center DOD Project Officer.
The final phase of training will combine what we've learned here with actual helicopter deployments, simulating a Mode 7 off-runway rescue capability.
Captain Jim Sills.
I am the airborne mission commander, or termed the air boss, and I'm responsible for all of the activities of the airborne aircraft assigned to the Department of Defense and to NASA when they fall under my operational control.
Okay, you guys, any problems?
Yeah.
I feel like everybody's trained real hard. I think we're ready to do it. This is kind of like our opening night. They present the problem to us, and we bring our troops in and take care of business.
Today we exercise the Mode 7, which simulates the shuttle missing the runway and landing in some of the water around Kennedy Space Center. We demonstrated something out of the ordinary by using one of the H-3 helicopters and landing it in the water. We demonstrated the use of the hoist with the HH helicopter, and the mission went better than expected.
Hopefully, you know, we don't have to do this business for real, but I feel confident that if we did, we'd get them.
At launch minus 10 minutes, all 4 of our jolly aircraft will be sitting at the shuttle landing facility on the ramp with our engines running and our rotors turning in the event there is any need for our support during the launch or immediately after the launch.
11. We have a go for main engine start. 6. 5. We have main engine start. 3, 2, 1, 0. We have solid rocket booster ignition.
Controlling roll maneuver confirmed. 15 seconds. Good roll.
Yukon, this is DOD Cape. You're cleared to proceed back to Patrick. Nice to know you guys were there if we needed you.
Roger, Cape. Our pleasure.
The segment you've just seen featured the 39th Aerospace Rescue and Recovery Wing. On April 7, 1984, a helicopter from the 39th crashed near Patrick Air Force Base, Florida, killing three members of that organization and two members of the Eastern Space and Missile Center.